Good afternoon, welcome to everybody. I'm Dr. Stephen Scheinman, President and Dean of the Commonwealth Medical College. Is this not a beautiful day? Even if it were raining outside, I would say that the sun is shining in here. On behalf of TCMC's Board of Trustees and the Chairman of our Board, Mr. Lewis de Naples, the faculty, the staff, and the students, I thank you all for joining us for the white coat ceremony for the class of 2019, as we welcome the members of TCMC's newest class to the profession of medicine. You are now the seventh class of MD students at TCMC, and with 105 students, you are also the largest class in our history. I would like to start by recognizing the families of our incoming medical students. Will the parents of the members of the class please rise? Stay up, because I now want to ask all the sisters and brothers and other members of the families of the class, please rise. I would also like to recognize the commitment and the amazing work performed every day by a group of dedicated, talented people, TCMC's faculty and staff. I would like to ask the members of our faculty and staff please to stand and be recognized. I'm pleased also to welcome the members of the community from Northeastern and North Central Pennsylvania who are with us today. TCMC was founded by this community, and more than any other medical school, TCMC is embraced by the community it serves. Thank you all sincerely for your support. It is my pleasure to introduce several members of the Board of Trustees who are in the audience today. I would like to ask them to rise. I see Dr. Robert Wright. I believe Dr. Robert Naismith and Dr. Susan Sordoni were expected anyway, and they're probably gonna, there she is, Dr. Sordoni. Just a late riser. Now I will introduce the stage party. I ask you to hold your applause until they're all introduced. I'll ask them each to stand and remain standing as your name is called. First, our speaker today, Dr. Howard Weitz from Thomas Jefferson University and Jefferson Health in Philadelphia. You will hear a more thorough introduction of Dr. Weitz, including his many titles, when he is presented today as the Dr. Lester Saidman Memorial Lecturer. Dr. William Yopst, Vice President for Clinical and Academic Affairs and Vice Dean. Dr. Linda Berardi-Demo, Associate Dean for Admissions and Student Affairs. Dr. Janet Townsend, with the longest title of all, Senior Associate Dean for Regional Campuses and Community and Educational Affairs and Regional Associate Dean for our West Campus. Dr. Shu Brichetti, Regional Associate Dean for our North Campus. And Dr. Michael Ferraro, Regional Associate Dean for our South Campus. You are surely aware that we also have a fourth campus, our Guthrie Campus in Sayre, and Dr. Dwight Stapleton, the Regional Associate Dean for the Guthrie Campus, was unable to be with us today, but he joins us in the celebration. So please indulge me now as I offer some reflections for the new members of the class of 2019. You are an amazing group with a remarkable diversity of experience. Even though with an average age of 23.4, you are the youngest class we've had yet. You have among you a licensed commercial pilot, a video game designer, a graphic designer, a landscaper, a quilter, a NASA-funded researcher, two entrepreneurs who own businesses, two former Teach for America volunteers, a number of serious athletes, including a mountain climber, a former professional hockey player, and a former ball girl for the Pittsburgh Pirates. Musicians in the class include a pianist, a violinist, a percussionist, several guitar players, and a cellist who played for the Chicago Metropolitan Symphony Orchestra. We expect to hear some of that on at the talent show. Dancers among you, who are also on notice for the talent show, do ballroom dancing, break dancing, traditional Greek dancing, Bhangra, and classical Indian dance. Many of you have traveled extensively, including a number who have performed service activities in countries like Haiti, the Dominican Republic, Panama, Liberia, Ghana, and Uganda. One of you has been to all seven continents, including Antarctica. I want to hear those stories. 21 of you have graduate degrees. Most of you speak another language, including more than half of you alone who speak Spanish. Several are trilingual, one speaks four languages, and one of you speaks five languages. 25 of you are the first member of your family to go to college. We are very proud of that. That percentage has been consistent across all of our classes, and we think it's wonderful. Clearly, you all have much to teach each other well beyond what you will learn in class. Today, the faculty of TCMC will cloak each of you with a white coat, a symbol of the professional obligation that you will bear proudly through your careers as physicians. As I said when I welcomed you on Monday, but bear with me because I want to repeat this for the benefit of your proud parents and family members and friends, there has never been a more exciting time to enter the medical profession. When I entered medical school 40 years ago, we never could have dreamed of targeted monoclonal therapy, molecular diagnostics, robotic surgery, computerized medical records, pharmacogenomics, fetal surgery, magnetic resonance imaging, or the many other exciting tools and toys that are taken for granted of now. And since the pace of medical discovery continues to accelerate, we can't even begin to imagine the many new modalities that will change medical care during the course of your careers. But with all that technology, what needs to remain constant through all of this, or even despite all of this, is your relationship with the patient. Many things in our brave new world of modern medicine conspire to separate you from your patients. These technical advances can tempt you to focus on the technique more than on the patient's pain. Technical advances have spawned subspecialization and fragmentation of care. These can distance you further from the person at the other end of your laparoscope. The bureaucracy of the medical insurance industry hasn't helped either. This is where oaths come in. They remind you that through all of this, your relationship with the patient is central to your identity as a physician. All American medical schools administer a version of the Hippocratic Oath at commencement. This, by the way, did not become universal until very recently. It was not universal in other centuries until the 20th century, and then only after World War II. It's not a widespread practice in other countries. The first time medical students were given an oath upon beginning medical school, was in 1993, just over 20 years ago, at the Columbia College of Physicians and Surgeons, where Dr. Arnold Gold was a pediatric neurologist on the faculty. It was through the active efforts of the Arnold P. Gold Foundation that white coat ceremonies now take place at most medical schools in the United States. In fact, I've just completed a survey. It is 88% of medical schools. When I went to medical school, it was unheard of. The oath you are about to take is unique to TCMC. It's relatively short, but encompasses all of the key elements of being a great physician. That your patients will be your first concern. That you are studying for their sake. That you acknowledge your limits. That's one of the hardest things for doctors to do. That you be gracious to your teachers and colleagues. This is not intended as self-serving, but a reflection of a phrase in the traditional Hippocratic Oath. That in your studies and in your life, you will manifest the dignity and integrity that your future patients will expect of you. That you practice humility. And a paraphrase of the lovely phrase from the Oath of Maimonides, may I never see in the patient anything but a fellow creature in pain. I encourage you to keep this oath in your hearts, to reread it at regular intervals during your odyssey through medical school, and particularly at the difficult times, to keep you in mind of your higher calling and your obligation to your future patients. It is my pleasure now to introduce not Dr. William Yopes, who is listed in your program, but Carol Greenwald, who is a member representing the Saidman family, to introduce today's Saidman lecture. So will Carol please come to the stage.
Dr. Yopes, I'm sorry for coming back from Nantucket early, but I would not have missed this for the world. I'm sorry. Okay. When my dad's children found out that the keynote speaker for the annual Lester Saidman Memorial Lecture was going to be Dr. Howard Weitz, there was only one question. Who was going to introduce Howard? Well, I won. I'm the oldest. I don't usually say that. I credit that to my sister. But suddenly, the reality of introducing the Dr. Howard Weitz, the Bernard L. Siegel Professor in Clinical Cardiology, the Director of the Division of Cardiology at Jefferson Heart Institute, the Senior Vice Chair for Academic Affairs in the Department of Medicine, and the Clinical Director of Jefferson's Heart and Vascular Service Line, was a bit overwhelming. Well, what does one do? In my case, I immediately called Howard, who said, forget the CV, which, by the way, is 32 pages and counting, and merely say that I am the professor of medicine and director of cardiology at Jefferson Hospital, and I love this part, and that I am an in-the-trenches cardiologist who takes care of patients and their families. Howard also gave me permission to say that he is involved in innovative aspects of medical education and the co-developer of the American College of Physicians internet-based show, Consult Guys, which is viewed worldwide and combines medical education for the practicing physician with humor and really is known as the medical equivalent of National Public Radio's Car Talk. If you get a chance, listen to it. I happen to love the one called Green Urine. I recently read in one of the announcements that Dr. Saidman's nephew-in-law, Howard Weitz, was a speaker. It took me back for a minute, because of course for us, Howard has always seemed ours. But in truth, it did take my beloved late cousin Barbara to bring this kind, this caring, this gentle man to our family. And best of all, he didn't run away from us, he stayed. I have some little known facts about the man. Howard irons his own clothes. He says he finds it relaxing. He also bakes bread for the same reason. He says it's relaxing. Howard is a bit of a time fanatic. When he says he will be someplace at 4:34 or 3:27 or 2:21, he is. I'm kind of curious about what time he left today. But this honorary talk was not given because Howard knows how to relax without playing golf, nor because he's always on time. It was to further medical education. That is what my father wanted. It is what my father believed in. It was clipped to his will in the form of a note. This money will be used for medical education. I've grown up surrounded by physicians. My father, Dr. Lester Saidman, was the ultimate family doctor, a man who loved learning and teaching and collecting New Yorker cartoons. He was a Renaissance man, yet he still called all of his 12 grandchildren Butch. My husband, Dr. David Greenwald, and my brother, Dr. Bruce Saidman, have continued to surround me with what I consider the best in medical care. In fact, I too had planned to be a physician until I found out that one must really know how to do math, stay through a biology class, the frogs did me in, and actually understand chemistry. But I do know what makes a great doctor, and I have had mentors, especially my dad, my husband, and my brother. Medicine is not a job. I don't even think it's a profession. I believe it to be a calling, as profound a calling as those callings felt, for example, by the clergy to serve God. Such a physician knows he or she has a calling to patients and to their families, and to put them above all else, at times even their own families. My cousin, Dr. Howard Weitz, will never stop educating, he will never stop learning, and he will never stop sharing all that he knows with his patients, his families, his students, and his colleagues. His pearls of wisdom are priceless. And by the way, he too is another Renaissance man. I recently asked my husband what a doctor's doctor is. And David said quite simply, Howard Weitz. So ladies and gentlemen, family, parents, and especially all of you new white coats, I give you the ultimate Dr. Howard Weitz, a people's doctor and a doctor's doctor. Thank you.
Carol, is that all? Do you want to keep going? No, thank you very much. It's a special pleasure to be here today because I'm here with family and friends and fellow faculty, and it's just a great honor for me. But I want to start off and tell you that before you give a scientific presentation, it's required to indicate, reveal any biases or conflicts of interest. And that's because the audience can then know in advance if they can really trust what the speaker has to say. The potential conflicts of interest should be revealed to the host, so the host can check out the conflicts before you're allowed on stage. Well, I have two conflicts of interest, and I did not let the president or the dean know in advance. And they may not let me go on after I reveal the conflicts. I'll let the audience decide whether I can go. The first is Dr. Lester Saidman. I knew him as Uncle Lester, my wife's uncle, who I adopted as my own. Uncle Lester was a unique character from the old school. Solo practitioner, on call 24/7 as a solo practitioner, and Uncle Lester even did house calls. Now, it's a little known fact that Uncle Lester, Dr. Lester Saidman, was the person who brought the concept of around-the-clock emergency care coverage to the Wilkes-Barre General Hospital. Can you imagine a hospital ER without around-the-clock physician coverage? That was routine in the old days, and Uncle Lester was an innovator in instituting that. He was someone out of the history book of medicine, and while his practice style was from a bygone era, his total commitment to his patients, their families, and his own family is an inspiration to us today. So I am biased toward the memory of Dr. Lester Saidman. The second bias is the Saidman-Greenwald families who've endowed this white coat speech. Now, I am one of their biggest fans, and if they had a fan club, I'd be the president and the chairman of the board. Because their commitment to this community is legendary, and it runs deep. In the Wyoming Valley, they're not only leaders in medical care, but they're pioneers in the support of the psychological and emotional well-being of their patients, and as or more importantly, their patients' families. And their contributions to this community are many and varied, and it's hard for me to imagine, that there's another family that's as committed and has given so much back to this region. So I've discussed my biases, my link to Dr. Saidman and the Saidman-Greenwald families, and now I want to mention my link to you, the class of 2019. For the class of 2019 and your friends and your families, today is a day that will rival your graduation from the Commonwealth Medical College. Because while May of 2019 will be the month that you graduate, today is the day that you really enter our profession. Today's the day. Over the next 4 years, you'll learn the skills to diagnose illness and care for patients and to interpret research and even perform research yourselves. And that research and those activities will impact on the lives of your patients and their families. Now, at graduation, you'll receive the degree that confirms what you've achieved, but today is the day that you cease being a civilian and you enter the calling of a healer. And that's how you and I are linked. We're healers, and it's my ultimate honor to welcome you as members of our profession. So I thought I would use our time together to tell you, class of 2019, what I think are the key secrets, the tips, the pearls of success in being a healer, not only in the care of your patients, but in the care of yourselves. And to start right now and use the approximately, and I've calculated, 1,370 days from today until graduation. So rent those hotel rooms now, parents. Rent the hotel rooms. And I will tell you that rather than wear the white coat of a professor of medicine, I'll feel more comfortable speaking with my new colleagues one-on-one if I wear the white coat that I received 41 years ago this month as a first-year medical student. I saved it for a special occasion. It happened today. So now I'm comfortable and we can talk one-to-one. And parents, families, and friends, I need you to listen carefully too, because you'll have a key and significant role in the satisfaction and success of your member of this class. Now first about yourselves, class of 2019. The deans have given me permission, even though classes don't start till next week, they give me permission to ask your first quiz question of medical school. This will be pass-fail, maybe the only pass-fail question, I don't know. And here's the question. How many of you have ever flown in an airplane? Please raise your hands. Ever flown in an airplane? I heard one of you flew the airplane, but okay, everyone's flown in an airplane. So while the next 4 years will be phenomenally gratifying, they'll be plain old stressful, difficult, and hard. So when faced with a difficult time, I want you to take the advice of the flight attendant who instructed you the last time you flew, in the event of emergency and deployment of oxygen, put the mask on yourself first and then assist others. Because I need you in times of personal stress to take care of yourselves first. Because if you're not taken care of, you cannot care for others. Be mindful of your health, get rest and exercise. I sound like a parent, and I am. And keep in contact with your family, friends, and members of this class. And now about your patients, and I want to tell you a few stories about a dad and three moms who've meant a lot to me, and I think they'll mean a lot to you. First, the dad. I never met Mr. Z, but I feel like I knew him because I've read most of his articles and books. He was the father of three daughters, a writer for the Wall Street Journal, and he wrote human interest pieces. He was known in his profession for his compassion and integrity, and one of Mr. Z's colleagues wrote that he took the extra steps to get it right because he believed that was the only way to do a job in work and in life. Now, in 2007, Mr. Z was writing a Wall Street Journal column about an event that was taking place in universities, and the event was called The Last Lecture. The Last Lecture. And The Last Lecture was a concept where beloved professors at universities were invited to give lectures as if they were their final lecture and focus on a summation of their lives and what really mattered most to them. Mr. Z had heard that Professor Randy Pausch of Carnegie Mellon University was giving his last lecture for real. Professor Pausch was dying from pancreatic cancer. Mr. Z felt that to cover this lecture to do the best job, he had to attend the lecture in person, not read a transcript, not watch a video. He had to be there. There were no flights from Detroit, where Mr. Z lived, to Pittsburgh that day. But as per his style of commitment to his craft, he drove the 300 miles from Detroit to Pittsburgh, sat in the audience. It was a 5-hour drive. Then he drove 5 hours back home. Because of his compulsive and thorough approach and the extra steps to get it right, the column was an overnight success and an instant success. It was read around the world, resulted in a YouTube viewed by more than 17 million viewers. It resulted in a book that sold 5 million copies in 48 languages. And it spread the message about life's meaning and led to countless thousands of people re-examining the meaning of their own lives. A 10-hour trip, a 1-hour lecture, an impact on millions. And in a talk that Mr. Z once gave, there was a message that applies to all of us in our profession of medicine. And that message was that we do not know what moment in our lives we're going to be judged on. And for us in medicine, we have an obligation to consider every single moment with our patients to be an important one. And we have to be honorable, honest, and work our hardest as advocates for our patients and their families. And now the three moms. Mrs. W came to me with cardiomyopathy, and that's the medical name for heart muscle weakness. And her heart muscle weakness was caused by the chemotherapy used to treat her breast cancer. Her heart was weak and too damaged to even respond to medications. Her only wish was to live long enough to attend her son's wedding, which was to occur in 4 months. She knew that her heart disease was incurable, but she had hope and trust in our advanced heart failure team that they'd be her advocates and explore all therapeutic modalities to maintain her comfort, keep her life as normal as possible, and maintain her dignity, and if at all possible, help her to be at that wedding. She wasn't asking for miracles. No, there were no miracles. She was asking for excellence and commitment to her care. Our advanced heart failure cardiologists and surgeons were able to insert a small pump, it's called a left ventricular assist device, into her left ventricle, and we attached it to a power supply that fit into her handbag. She not only saw her son get married, she danced at the wedding with the left ventricular assist device. And the years were good to Mrs. W. She went on to become a grandmother twice. But a few years ago, the breast cancer returned with a vengeance and was unstoppable. She slipped into a coma, and as per her advance request, the left ventricular assist device that had given her life with quality and meaning for an almost 5 years, five wonderful years, was turned off, and she passed away with dignity and with her family at her side. The next mom was Mrs. D. Now, Mrs. D was 27 years old when I met her, and here's her story. She had delivered twin sons 1 week before at another hospital and was discharged to home 2 days after the boys were born. But shortly after, Mrs. D developed fever and shortness of breath, and she thought she was coming down with the flu or was just overtired as a mom of twins. 3 days later, she was so short of breath, she couldn't lay flat and noticed her legs were swollen. She came to Jefferson's emergency department, and after initial evaluation, I was asked to see her. We diagnosed that she was in heart failure, and an ultrasound examination of her heart showed the heart muscle was barely squeezing. The muscle was barely squeezing. She had postpartum cardiomyopathy, heart muscle weakness following childbirth, the cause of which is unknown. And adding to the problem, it was a Friday night that I saw her, was the finding that because of her sluggish heart blood flow, a large blood clot had formed in her heart's main pump, the left ventricle. And on ultrasound, it had the appearance of a golf ball tethered to the left ventricle by a thin strand of clotted blood. And on that Friday night, my worry for this mom of 1 week was that the strand would break and the blood clot would travel to her brain and cause a stroke. Now, it was my role to assess the options for Mrs. D. And I balanced the risks and benefits of various therapies, and while heart surgery was high risk, other therapies were even more dangerous. And most importantly, and key, was the boys needed their mom. That night, we took Mrs. D to the operating room and performed open heart surgery to remove the potentially deadly clot held in place by a fragile strand. The post-op course was stormy. She needed medications and heart support machines because of her weakened heart muscle, but she showed improvement, was weaned off support agents, and believe it or not, she was discharged to home, to the boys. I saw her a year later when she came back with a stroke. Her heart function was normal, but the stroke, which was a small stroke, was not the result of heart disease. It was the result of an autoimmune process that made her blood thicker than normal. She was then scheduled to see me as an outpatient, but she never returned. She never returned until 18 years after her heart surgery, 17 years after her missed outpatient visit. And why the need for follow-up? She had seen a new physician who, when hearing her story, suggested she see a cardiologist. She thought she was cured and didn't need one. So she tracked me down and scheduled an appointment. So what happened during those years? 2 weeks from today, the twins will be 21 years old. Their biggest challenge was whether to stay together or go to separate colleges. The boys stayed together, and in September, they'll be college juniors. Their mom's heart function is normal. The process that made her blood thicker than normal has resolved, and she has no remnant of the stroke of years ago. Now, she's had other major medical issues, which her family and she have faced with courage and commitment. I saw Mrs. D 3 weeks ago. I told her about my meeting with the class today, and I asked her what got her through the experience of devastating heart disease just a few days after becoming a mom, and what's continued to help her lead a life of optimism during repeated medical challenges. She told me it's a continued combination of hope and trust, that her physicians will do all they can to help her battle illness with the same conviction that got her home to the boys 21 years ago. Now, the final mom is Mrs. G. Now, Mrs. G came to me with an aortic aneurysm. Her aorta, the aorta is the large blood vessel in the chest. It had ballooned to more than double, almost triple normal size. And not only was it at risk of tearing, it had stretched her aortic valve dramatically, and the valve was leaking severely. Surgery for her would have been unthinkable when I first got this student white coat. but at my hospital now, it's done on a regular basis. After her initial surprise that the cause of her shortness of breath was this major cardiovascular abnormality, Mrs. G had an amazing calm. She told me it was her hope that I assemble the best surgical team that I could to fix the aneurysm, replace the valve, and then get her back to work and to her six children, and at that time, three grandchildren. And I told Mrs. G that she could trust me to do that. For our surgical team, the operation was complex, but complexity for them is routine. They had to lower her body temperature to 65 degrees Fahrenheit so that her organs and brain could withstand the 17 minutes that they had to stop her circulation and repair her aorta and replace the valve. 17 minutes of no circulation. A few years ago, Mrs. G was with me as I presented her story to our, at the time, second year medical students. I told the class that she was awake 5 hours after surgery and went home on the sixth postoperative day. She told the students that her life returned to normal and that within 4 weeks after surgery, she resumed her full-time occupation as a grief counselor in support of patients with cancer. Now, I see Mrs. G on a regular basis, and when I called her for an update in preparation for today, she was too busy to talk on the telephone. She was running a grief support group, so she had to call me back. I asked her again what she remembered most about that time almost 6 years ago. And it still was and is her comfort in having been given hope and trust, that those caring for her would be committed to her care and be excellent in delivery of that care. Now, ladies and gentlemen, there's a special link to today's ceremony. I'm honored to say that Mrs. G is here today in this audience, and she's given me permission to tell who she is and tell her story. And with her full permission, Mrs. G is Carol Greenwald, the woman who introduced me a few moments ago. Carol? So, class, what are the secrets that I've learned and are taught by the stories of countless patients like the dad and the three moms? Or in other words, what is your prescription for success in our profession? First, be mindful of your health, because if you are not healthy, it makes it tough to be the health care advocate for others. Put your oxygen on first. Second, go the extra step, or extra 100, or 1,000 steps, if that's what's needed to bring excellence to what you do. Third, give your patients realistic reasons for hope and be worthy of their trust in you that you will do what's best for them. You will not be able to perform miracles. You will not be performing miracles, but lead a life where your patients know you'll be there with them in good times as well as times that are not so good. Fourth, and this is key. Until today, the beneficiary of your striving for excellence has been you. You've worked for the grade point average, the good MCAT scores, and you succeeded and you are in, and I will repeat, you are in. But you know, when we assembled our teams to care for Mrs. W, Mrs. D, and Mrs. G, I never asked the physicians of my teams what colleges they went to, what medical schools they went to, what their MCAT scores were, who made Dean's List, or who even did extracurricular activities. For me, I selected the members of the team based on their clinical excellence and their hard work on behalf of patients. So a real key to your success in our profession is to be able to make the needs of your patients the reason for your continued commitment to excellence. Your teachers will lead the way, but it's your patience will really teach you, and your satisfaction will come for what you do for them and their families. Fifth and final, the big secret. The big secret is, it's about the people. Yourselves, your colleagues, your teachers, the medical teams you'll be part of, your friends and family, and importantly, your patients. Years from now, when you look back on your careers, like I have done on mine, you will not remember the preparation to get into medical school. You will not remember it. You won't remember the first biochem test. It'll be long gone. And to be painfully honest, and this really hurts, you will not remember today's white coat speech. And that's a fact of life. But when you do look back, you remember the people, because the secret is, it's always about the people. Good luck and welcome aboard.
So on behalf of the entire Commonwealth Medical College community, I would like to thank you profoundly for your wonderful comments. I think you gave 105 new medical students many, many things to ponder and gave them a brief glimpse into the wonderful future they have as physicians. I think you also now have 105 medical students who will be saving their white coats, not knowing why, but afraid to give them up. And it is also my privilege to present you this plaque of appreciation as our second annual Lester Saidman lecturer. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
It is now my pleasure to introduce Dr. Berardadimo. Dr. Berardadimo is our Associate Dean of Admissions and Student Affairs for the presentation of the White Coats.
Good afternoon. Wow, what a speech. I almost cried, I think, at one point during that. Maybe I was the only one, huh? It is now my pleasure to call the students forward to receive their white coats. Presenting white coats for the class of 2019 will be Dr. Shobra Shetty and Dr. Michael Ferraro. Will the students of the class of 2019 please stand to receive your white coats? Edmund Abdu. Antonio Andalita. Bronson Allen. Michael Ambrose. Laura Barna. Sean Bazil. Alexander Betts. Caitlin Bovino Ring. Numita Bhopal. Christian Bowen. Andrea Borba. Brendan Bormes. Elizabeth Boyle. Sabrina Brunozzi. Victor Cabello. Miranda Chacon. Christine Chen. Quan Chen. Suleiman Chowdhury. Jordan Chu. Catherine Chung. Jesse Clayton. Ian Coote. Brandon Cope. Holly Corkle. Janke Dave. Emily Delp. Zachary D'Angelo. Brent DiGiorgio. Benjamin Dixon. David Dorbad. Nicolette Drescher. Christopher Edwards. Andrew Federo. Darla Fink. Ryan Flick. Shelley Gar. Kelly German. Rebecca Greiser. Jason Gu. Mary Handel. Cassandra Hartman. Brendan Hawara. David Henry. Nathan Hoff. Adam Holina. Mikael Horisian. Joseph Hornack. Nicole Klein. Natasha Kohanzadeh. Ashley Labdick. Catherine Larrabee. Jenna Littman. Gabriella Lagroño. Megan Lombardi. William Lotney the Fourth. Rachel Lovely. Alexandra Lucas. Amelia McCary. Michael Marker. Nicole Marinelli. Stephen Mazurkovich. Curran McCabe. Connor McDonald. William McLaughlin. Kaylee Medden. Jay Moon. Jessica Morales. Michael Morgan. Marco Najar. Kathleen Neillian. Nicole Ojijijaku. Akindile Oluganju. John Orr. Eduardo Ortiz. James Palma D'Souza. Robert Parajan. Jacob Herrick. Jenna Patel. Curran Perry. Danielle Peters. Madeline Plessinger. William Preston. Timothy Reidlinger. M. Brett Ritchie. Sarah Rosebaugh. Tina Roy. Diane St. Victor. Kristen Sama. Daniel Saveria. Catherine Schmidt. Tom Zawatsky. Anil Shah. Avisha Shah. Hannah Snyder. Tripti Soni. Amy Sodal. Christopher Sullivan. Chloe Swanger. Nicholas Cislianos. Brian Velasco. Shane Warnock. Ariane Wenk. Leanne Wadwuski. Elise Zhao. Let's have a round of applause for all of our students. It is now my pleasure to introduce Dr. Janet Townsend, who will lead the class in reciting the oath.
Please stand and join me as we recite the medical student oath, which is found in your program. As a physician in training, my patients will be my first concern. I will strengthen myself with the knowledge and compassion to care for them. I will acknowledge my limits, seeking help when needed. I will be gracious with my teachers and colleagues. I will manifest the dignity and integrity inherent in the noble profession to which I aspire. I will treat everyone thoughtfully and with respect. At all times, may I never see in the patient anything but a person in need. This oath I take freely upon my honor. Please join me in congratulating the class of 2019. So students, please keep this oath in your heart and take your seats.
It is now my great pleasure to be the first to say to you as a group, welcome to the profession. If you all thought that that line of students, 105 students, was long, I want you to imagine the line of the 7,284 applicants for these seats. Amazing. I must say, you all look great. You look marvelous in your new white coats. On Monday, you will begin the hard work of becoming a doctor. It will involve learning a lot of facts, which are not nearly as important as learning how to gather and process information, how to think like a doctor, how to become a lifelong learner. Our curriculum has you working with patients from the very beginning, so these white coats will soon be your work clothes. But they can be a danger, too. Some doctors succumb to the temptation to think of their white coat as a shield or as armor, a barrier, a status symbol. Taking care of patients is a frightening thing. The responsibility is intimidating, but more than that, the patient's illness is frightening. It reminds you that you are vulnerable, that you are mortal, that you will someday be a patient. If you are not grounded and mature and comfortable with your own mortality, it's hard to be there for your patients as you need to be. And that's a lot to expect. And it is something that the white coat does not really help you with. Some doctors create a distance between themselves and the patients as a defense mechanism. They stand at the foot of the bed using long Latin terms that we will teach you, talking about the patient in the third person, wearing their white coats proudly, as if it says to the patient that you're not like them, that you're above them, as if it says that you are safe from becoming a patient. You will not be one of those doctors. You were selected from a very large pool on the basis of not just your academic excellence, but more importantly, your experiences and your character. Then the values of TCMC, which are woven into our curriculum, are focused on the patient. You will be as well. You will come to see this white coat not as a symbol of status, but as a reminder that your role is one of service to the community and to your patients. In that spirit, you should wear it very proudly. So to TCMC's class of 2019, I offer with excitement my sincere welcome to TCMC and to the medical profession. To the audience, I ask that you remain seated while our students and the stage party exit. I invite everyone to a reception at our Medical Sciences Building at 525 Pine Street. Thank you all very much.